As I was saying to our younger folks, today is Christ the King Sunday, or the Reign of Christ Sunday. And this happens within our liturgical calendar. The last Sunday before Advent begins is the particular Sunday in which we focus on Christ the King, Christ as King, or the Reign of Christ. Now, the Reign of Christ is something that is, along with thinking about Jesus as a king, too, I guess, it's a little harder to get a handle on or grasp, because it's both something that is somewhat present, but is not fully present, has broken in some ways, but has not fully, it's not been fully developed. It's not fully the reign of God as God would have us have it, human beings interact with one another. Now we get plenty of visions or pictures of what it would be like, the reign of Christ. And in that, in those visions, like we heard Mary read from the prophet Ezekiel, people's basic needs are all taken care of, like the sheep that we heard about in Ezekiel. Those that are scattered and lost are gathered back in, so they're not alone. When they're hungry, they're fed. When they're thirsty, they get a place to drink. When they need a safe place to live, they have it there in the pasture. And their wounds are bound up. And so we have this vision of what life in the reign of Christ looks like. All people's needs, basic needs, are taken care of. And that God is a part of that. That in the first part of the Ezekiel passage, it's God's self who's taking care of the sheep. And then in the second part, it's God's servant David. And so we know that God is invested in the world looking like this. Now we honestly have to, when we look around at our world, we say, does it look like that? Not so much. And so we also have to say that, do we have a part in making this happen, or not really? Because there are people of faith, there are Christians, who say, you know what, it's not my job to have or help the reign of God be more manifest in the world. It's not my job to make that happen. That's God's job, and when God does it, everything will be fine. God takes care of everything, you know, everybody will get along, everybody's needs will be met, it'll be fine. But that's not my job. Now there are other Christians, other of us, who don't believe that that's how it works. And we particularly don't believe that, I think, because we know that Jesus came into the world and lived in the world as fully divine and also fully human. And as he was participating in life in the world, he didn't just stand around and go, hey, you know what? Don't worry about anything. God's going to take care of all this. Now, he went from place to place, and he preached, he taught, and he himself healed people. He himself fed people. He talked about the importance of us doing this for and with one another. Jesus took an active role in bringing about the reign of God. And I think that's the model that we're called to follow. And in our third scripture passage, Jesus makes this even clearer. So I'd ask that we might listen for the word of God as it's found in the gospel according to Matthew, reading from the 25th chapter, verses 31 through 46. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, come, you that are blessed by God, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of our family, you did it to me. Then he will say to those at his left hand, you are accursed. Depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. And they will answer, Lord, when was it we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you? And he will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. May God bless this reading from Holy Scripture. So Jesus lays out what the reign of God, what the reign of Christ looks like, and it's pretty straightforward. In the reign of God, when someone's hungry and we meet that person, we feed them. When someone's thirsty, we give them something to drink. When they're a stranger, we welcome them. Now, we as people of faith, as a congregation, we work to try to meet the needs of many, many people. And as individuals, we do that. We offer food in many different ways. We volunteer at New Hope Ministries, and that's a place where people are fed. We work to make sure that people have something to drink. We try to welcome strangers. So we do that as individuals and as a congregation. So we can hear this and we go, okay, we're doing this, that's good. And it is up to a point. Because the reign of God is not anywhere near complete. And we recognize that. We know that. We know there are still people who are naked without clothes. We know there are people who are sick and aren't being taken care of. We know that there are people who are in prison and see little to no hope. We know that. And we don't always attend to those folks. Or we don't attend to them as often as they need the attention. And we can be tempted then to just sort of throw up our hands and go, how can any one person or any one congregation take care of all the needs that are out there? And the answer to that question is, no one person or no one congregation can. That's just the reality. We can't do it all. But do we just stop trying then? Is that what comes through in this passage? Jesus goes, well, all right, you give me your best shot, and then if it doesn't take care of everything and everyone, then that's okay. Now, that's pretty clear. That's not what Jesus is saying. And so then we're asked to be honest with ourselves and say, what do we do in the face of this? What do we do in the face of in the communities we live in, and the country we live in, and the world we live in? How do we follow what Jesus, who we claim, believe is our King, is telling us to do, if we can't take care of all those needs all by ourselves? Well, we do know that there are other organizations out there that feed people and help give water and drink to people and welcome people. We know that. Well, so we can support those organizations. Perhaps we can work with or volunteer in those organizations. We also know that in order for those organizations to function, they need help, they need funding, they need resources. And so we have governments that can do that. We have local governments, we have state governments, we have our federal government that can do that. So we need to advocate to make sure that these needs of all these people are being met. Oh yeah, maybe we can do that. That sounds like it's getting kind of political though. If we think about that, if we talk about that. I don't know if I want to go there. See, and that's the kicker. Because Jesus doesn't just say, look, you need to feed the hungry. You need to clothe the naked. Take care of the sick. Jesus just doesn't say that in this passage. What Jesus says is, whenever you feed somebody who's hungry, you've just fed me. Whenever you clothed someone that was naked, you just clothed me. Whenever you visited someone in prison, you just visited me. So all those people that are hungry and thirsty and strangers, they're not just statistics. They're not just numbers. They're people. And they're people within whom Jesus resides. And Jesus says to us, would you deny me if you believed it was me? Would you say, no, I'm not going to feed you if you know it was me that was you were talking to? Or me that represented one of those people throughout your country or community who you're saying, you know what, I don't think we're going to feed those folks. That's the question Jesus is asking us. That's the point that Jesus is bringing us to. It is in establishing that kind of relationship, because after all, that's what it's always about, is establishing that kind of relationship, recognizing that that kind of relationship exists so that when we feed somebody, we know that we're not only feeding an individual, but we're feeding God, and we're helping to bring God's reign further into being. And we have to recognize that relationship, because we do need to draw courage and strength for doing what we need to do to make sure as many people who are hungry are fed, thirsty are given drink, ill are taken care of. And we have to draw up that courage because we're living in a time and a place in which those needs are not being talked about in a way in which they're going to be met to a greater extent, but rather we're talking about a time in which we're taking away so much of that aid and support. We're doing away with SNAP benefits, which used to be also known as food stamps, that fed people. Now, we don't need those anymore, we're being told. Let's cut that out of the budget. We don't need to protect people's drinking water. They can figure out a way to do that themselves. They can buy water in plastic bottles. We don't need to take care of everybody's health needs, because that's just too expensive and too difficult to do. So we'll take away the resources that were geared and going in that direction to help people. We don't really need to visit people in prison or take care of people in prison, because they're criminals. They don't need to be rehabbed. They don't need help with their addictions. They don't need help with their education. They don't need help with their mental health. No, we'll just take away money. We'll privatize that, and we'll let somebody make some money off of them instead. And we're saying that we're going to take money away from all those things so that we can give more money to people who already have money. A lot of it. Trickle down economics. You know, in Scripture, Jesus talks about trickle-down economics. We run across it in the story of Lazarus and the rich man and the scraps he sometimes got from his table. We run across that story when Jesus meets the woman who is begging for food. And in fact, he even says, well, you know, this food has to go to the people who I'm closest to first. And she begs for scraps off his table. And Jesus says that's not enough. Scraps from the table, trickle-down economics, they don't meet the needs of the people who have them. They never have, and they never will. That's a reality. So the question that we have before us is, what do we do in the face of that? What do we do? Do we shrug our shoulders? I guess there's nothing I can do about it. You know, it's happening way off, way somewhere away from me, beyond my power, beyond my control. Or do we take a deep breath and go, you know what? This isn't bringing the reign of God further into being. This isn't what the person I claim is my king is asking me to do. I got to not only do the work I can do as an individual, and we need to not only do the work that we do as a congregation, but we also need to reach out beyond that. And we need to advocate, and we need to raise our voices, and we need to put our lives on the line and say, no, we can't cut back what people need. We need to increase it. And we're going to work until people hear that and figure it out. It's not easy. You know, if it was easy, we would have figured it out already. If we as human beings tended to think and act in that way, just regularly, normally, we would have done it by now. Intelligent people, we're resourceful people. This goes against the flow. And it will be hard. But it's what we're called to do. It's what we're called to do. Because all those people out there with all those needs, who we have ideas how to take care of, but we continue to choose to ignore them, God is in each and every one of them. And are we willing to say we're willing to ignore God? I don't think we are. I don't think we are. But now we've got to figure out what we are willing to do. Amen.